they can do something. So there's been, there's such a thing called standing. So we'll use the airline example. If I'm a frequent flyer and spend a certain amount of money, I have standing. Mm-hmm. So when I lose a piece of luggage, I get three emails by the time I land that something's happening. And people know that that's happening. So they know that the cogs can work, that the 10,000, the 100,000 people can make the experience enjoyable. But they're not doing it for me. They're doing it for others. And I think that happens in every example you've used, that there's a certain class of people of which, you know, certain people are in that can accomplish the satisfaction that we're all seeking.
Yeah, but I'm a frequent flyer also. and I happened to find myself in Charlotte and landed and stuck. And I say, I'm a frequent flyer. Can't you do something about it? They say, no, that doesn't work here.
But they still, you know, they know that they can do it. They do it for certain people.
And they do it for a lot of people.
Yeah.
That's exactly right, that's why I'm not using a mic.
All right. You ought to be up here giving this damn lecture. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just curious. I'm a political scientist, so I go out at it from a different perspective, but I think part of what we used to have was something called the common good or the common interest as a concept. And so even though we may not understand fully our own role, we had some mission that we thought we together could accomplish. And I think that has dissolved in our society, that leaves us isolated and coping with that sense of why am I here, why am I doing this, and why am I listening to him. But our sense of common ground, I think, has eroded. And to me, that's one of the causes for what you're talking about.
There is a slow erasure of what used to be the common good. And I think that's not difficult to regain that so long as two conditions are met. One, that there's an adequate explanation as to why the common good is common, mm-hmm. why it matters to all of us. And the second one is an actual demonstration of how it matters. Normally, we get canned explanations of what the common good is. Canned explanations of that come out of Congress, for instance. I don't mean to lean on Congress too heavily because it's too easy to do that. But I think we need to have honesty. Let me tell you an absolutely true story of a young man who gave his soul to work for a representative, federal U.S. rep. And they got close and they got to be friendly. And at one point the rep said the following. He said, "It's all sincerity. It's all sincerity. And when you get to the point where you can fake it, you'll be elected." Yeah. All sincerity that you fake. So what we need is not fake sincerity, but a simple respect. You know, okay, every one of us deserves respect. Not every one of us gets it. In fact, very, very few people get, as you were saying, special people. Well, we're all special people. But it's extremely difficult to get the kind of, well, how shall I put it, honest respect that we all deserve. Nobody? Oh, yes, sir.
I'm part of an organization that went through a period of having a problem where the organization was pretty evenly split over whether it should make some observations, add some wisdom to this. And one thing this group said was, we're trying to solve this problem by taking a vote, and the side that has one more vote mm-hmm. than the other side will prevail, and everybody will have to do mm-hmm. what the one vote majority decided. Is that kind of decision making related to this? And is there, are there other ways that we should be looking at making decisions that affect all of us or large groups of people rather than the one vote majority?
The idea is to talk it out, not to take a vote. Talk it out. Under normal circumstances, if you talk long enough, you'll have some kind of insight or some kind of decision. But the decision will happen. Students come to me and say, what should I do? What kind of job should I take? The senior is petrified at the idea of being in out there in the world. And I said, don't make a decision, grow a decision. You know, so talking grows a decision. Instead of saying, hey, it's 99 versus 98, and the 98, everybody swallows hard and hates everybody else because just one vote would have made a difference. Instead of that, talk. If it's not enough talk, then talk some more. And at some point, you will draw a decision that everybody can adopt, or at least the vast majority of people can adopt, that will contribute to the common good.
That's where it comes from.
I know. Yes, sir.
I'm still stuck back at the screwdriver in your thumb.
I was stuck there myself.
Yeah. Maybe I misunderstand your point, but I try to put myself in your shoes, and if I had used my thumb to screw it in, I think that would have made me unhappy because it would have hurt. But if I used my trusty little mediator to screw the screw in, I think I'd be happy. Further, some of my tools I like so much, I almost like have a relationship. Like I love my car. I don't know. Does that make some sense to you, or am I on the wrong track?
Not only does it make sense, but it's exactly what I should have said and obviously didn't. What I have in mind is mediation is hugely good. It makes possible all kinds of things that without it wouldn't be impossible. Imagine the inhabitants of New York spreading out over the countryside, securing food instead of having these Kroger and other huge companies bringing it in.
Is that a question of degree? I mean, like when there's too much mediation?
No, I don't think it can. If we were to get rid of mediation, we would be very unhappy. Mediation is hugely good, but it has a cost. And the book that's to come out is called The Cost of Comfort. I'm all for the comfort. But it hurts because it costs.
I see. Thanks.
Okay? Thank you for taking my mind.